Pesach is coming up, and there's lots to say, there's lots to prepare for the Pesach, and so I thought of giving a short introduction, especially for this year, where Pesach is going to start. Leil HaSeder, the Seder night, will be on a Saturday night. So things are a little bit different because of Shabbat. The Shabbat is leading towards Pesach. But let's start from the beginning. We've just entered the month of Nisan, and we have something very special, that a special bracha that can be said only during the month of Nisan, and that is called Birkat Ha'ilanot, the bracha for the trees. Now with Pesach in the month of Nisan, it's springtime. Now already, and with time, you know, in the next few weeks, everything will wake up. The whole nature will start flourishing. And the rabbis told us, don't get stuck at home in front of your computer the whole day. Go out and see the flowers and smell the flowers. And if you see two fruit trees flourishing or beginning of flowers, you can say and you should say a very beautiful and special bracha. Baruch ata shel melech ha'olam, shelo chisar be'olamo klum. Thank you, God, for not missing anything in your world. Uvara bo briot tovot ve'ilanot tovim lehanot bahem b'nei adam. And you, God, created in this perfect world beautiful people and beautiful trees for the people to benefit from, for us to enjoy. It's a very nice bracha that can be said only once a year, only during the month of Nisan, and you should try and make the effort saying that bracha in the next few weeks. Another thing, coming closer to Pesach, is called Kimcha de Pischa. Kimcha de Pischa, whenever you see a series of words ending with the letter Aleph, you know it is Aramaic and not Hebrew. Kimcha in Hebrew is Kemach. De Pischa, De means shell, of. Pischa, Pesach. Kemach shel Pesach, the flower of Pesach. That refers to the fact that we have to remember the underprivileged, you know, the less privileged people, those who have less, and it's our obligation, if we are lucky to have a little bit more, to help them and to give them. Pesach is a relatively expensive festival. For 7 days, we have to eat something which is much more expensive than bread, and that's the matzah. And aside from the other food, that kosher for Pesach is relatively more expensive than other food. And so we have to try and help those who have less. And the best way of helping is to give them a job. That's the best way. The second best is to give them a loan. All those ideas is how to help people without them feeling sorry for themselves or being embarrassed. But if you can give, and if you can give without seeing who you're giving to, it's even better. But anyway, try to give some charity. That's important. Coming closer to Pesach, what Pesach is most famous for, and that's, I think, wrongly, is for the cleaning. Cleaning towards Pesach is the... I don't want to break it to you, but there was a rabbi called Rav Shlomo Aviner, who years ago wrote already that you can get ready for Pesach in terms of cleaning in half a day. That's enough. And more than that, remember, he said, you know, he's a little bit cynical. He said this sentence, you know, Avak ze lo chametz, vehaba'al ze lo korban Pesach. Dust is not chametz, and your husband is not the sacrifice of Pesach. You don't have to put him on the altar and smack him from side to side so you won't bring chametz to unleavened bread to into the house. And so remember the most important thing is for the Seder to have meaning and for us to say things. Remember the beautiful word, Pesach. Pesach, it's a festival of Pesach. Pesach, the literal meaning is Passover. You know, we passed over because God passed over the houses of the Jews when he killed all the firstborns of the Egyptians. That's the origin of the word, but we play on word. And Pesach also actually means Pesach, Pe Medaber, the mouth speaks. And that's what Pesach is about. That's what the Seder night is about. It's not about reaching it dead because you've been working too hard for weeks before and then you reach what it's about and then you're dead. Luckily this year, you won't have any excuses. It won't happen because we have Shabbat leading to Pesach. On Shabbat, we're not allowed to clean. And on Shabbat, we should rest. And so this year's Pesach will be very nice as we all going to be spiritually prepared as well as physically because we're all going to have time to sleep and to prepare things to say during Shabbat and before. And remember, try to make the Pesach a positive experience, not something that you boss around everyone around you and you tell them to don't step here and eat over the toilet seat. Don't go there. Don't do that. Do things calmly, and that's very important. It must be a family experience, a positive family experience. And so remember what chametz is. Although it says in the Torah that we shouldn't have any non-kosher for Pesach food. But remember, when the Torah speaks about any, it means the minimum size of kazait. Kazait is half a slice of bread or as big as a matchbox. That's how big chametz that you shouldn't have more than that. But smaller than that is not considered anything. So if you left a few crumbs somewhere, it's not the end of the world. We're going to talk in a minute how we actually say that all this chametz means nothing to us and we don't care about it and we don't want it, and that's good enough. If you don't have any big pieces of cookies that someone left somewhere, you don't have to worry. So if you have children like I do, that they would move biscuits, whatever, from side to side, then you're right. You have to check. And you have to check. But again, it doesn't mean you have to clean the windowsills and in between the tiles on the floor and on top of the light fittings. That's not what Pesach is about. Pesach is about trying to make it meaningful. And that's by cleaning. Yes, you have to get rid of the chametz. It says, Bali ra'eh uvali matzeh. You shouldn't have in your possession any non-kosher for Pesach food, but you don't have to get crazy. So the cleaning of the house is mainly in the kitchen. 90% of the cleaning should be in the kitchen. You don't have to dust all your books now. Yes, it's an opportunity, but it's nothing to do with Pesach. You can clean your whole house thoroughly, but it doesn't mean it must be done before Pesach. So I'm going to go through in a few minutes the basic laws. It's an opportunity of how to make your utensils kosher for Pesach and cutlery and plates and everything that you have and pots and pans. How do you make them kosher for Pesach? We've learned about this in our other lessons, but let's go quickly because it's the same rules. The same rule apply. If you want to make a dish from non-kosher to become kosher, or from milk to meat, or from meat to milk, or from non-kosher for Pesach to kosher for Pesach. That, all of those things, we use the same basic rule. Three words in Hebrew. You understand them, you understand the laws of kashrut. Kevol'o, kach polto. The same temperature that the dish absorbed, it will get rid of what was absorbed in it. For example, if you have something that you used on a fire, the way to make it kosher is again to put it on a fire. If you have something that you used only cold, then you make it kosher cold. Now, in terms of Pesach, you don't have to buy dishes for Pesach. You can just use for those 7 days. Remember, Pesach is 7 days. You can use a disposable or some things you can make kosher from your usual dishes. Remember, if it's something cold, you don't have to make it kosher. For example, the fridge, clean it well, get rid of all the chametz, and then you can put everything there. The oven, remember, you again clean properly, and then you put it for about an hour on the highest temperature to burn itself. Those trays inside the oven, we cannot make kosher. The only way is to cover them. There is amazing invention that was probably invented for the Jewish people to be able to keep kosher easily, and that invention is called tin foil. Tin foil is excellent. It will help you all over the world, wherever you visit, in terms of kashrut and also in terms of Pesach. So tin foil, niyar kesef, aluminium, what we do is we cover those trays inside the oven, and then you can use them. With the microwave, again, you clean it well, and then you take a glass or something plastic with water inside. For 10 minutes, you make it work, and that will make your microwave kosher for Pesach. Surfaces, it's impossible to clean. You try to clean properly and you throw hot water on it. But then what we do is we cover the surfaces. We cover the shaish where next to the sinks, we cover. Even the sink, we put something inside, but you don't really have to. This is not something so important. Other than that, the actual gas area where you cook, that's always not kosher. So it stays like that. You clean it from leftovers of chametz, and that's it. Remember all the little places that you tend to forget. If you have a baby, then in a baby's chair, there's lots of chametz. If you have a car, then again, in the car, you have to clean properly. People often throw things there or drop or forget. So the pram, the baby's cot, the kids' bags, that's very important to clean the kids' bags, because often you find something there that has been there for 5 years that you cannot even recognize what it was, what kind of food it was. And that's what we find in a kid's bags. And that's good to clean and very important. There are certain things, certain kinds of foods that don't really need to be kosher for Pesach, meaning they are kosher for Pesach the whole year. And that I refer to things that are not processed food. Basic materials like coffee, tea, sugar, salt, honey, fish, chicken, meat. When I say meat, I don't refer to a kebab or a hamburger or sausages. We're talking about real meat, pieces of meat. They are kosher. Milk, wine, butter, all those things can be eaten. No problem. No problem without a sign kosher for Pesach, but usually you will find it with a sign. Luckily, we live in Israel that everything have a sign kosher for Pesach, although not everything needs. For example, cosmetics or soaps or medicine that you swallow, medication, things that you don't taste them. All those things don't need kosher for Pesach, but if they do, it's nice. Even toothpaste doesn't need kosher for Pesach, but if it does, it's nice. If you make it, you know, we always try, you know, you change your toothbrush from time to time. We try to change before Pesach, but even if you didn't, nothing happened. It's all okay. certain things don't need kosher for Pesach, whether it's Coke, Coca-Cola, Diet Cola, the same thing, olive oil, canola oil, don't need kosher for Pesach. I don't know if you're Ashkenazi or Sephardi, if you eat tahini, tchina, doesn't need kosher for Pesach, or soya oil, soy oil or corn oil, that's only for Sephardi, or corn, only for Sephardi, but it also doesn't need kosher for Pesach. Vegetables, fruits, obviously, it's all okay, but try to buy everything before, and everything will be ready for Pesach. Only medication that has got a taste and that you benefit, that you enjoy, that whether it's a syrup or something that you you swallow, that you suck, like sweets that help your throat, that need kosher for Pesach because you enjoy it. But thing that you just swallow, no problem. It doesn't need kosher for Pesach. Remember, with the whole concept of kitniot, lentils, those for Ashkenazi don't eat and the Sephardi do eat, it shouldn't be something that's separating between the Jews. So if Ashkenazi come to eat at the Sephardi house, then he won't eat the rice, but he would eat the chicken that was cooked with the rice. It's okay. It's not like chametz. People make it to be much more than it really is. So you don't have to make too much a big thing of it. Okay, now something else with regards to mechirat chametz, the sale of the chametz. If you have food that you didn't manage to finish, and it's not kosher for Pesach, whether it is a bottle of whiskey or whether it's your dog food, you should buy kosher for Pesach for your animals' food as well. But whether it is whatever, something, your pasta that is not kosher for Pesach, and you didn't finish it, and you don't want to throw it away, then we can sell it. We sell our chametz through the rabbi. I'm going to send you this whole list of that I made of things that, in terms of preparation for Pesach. I'm going to send it to you in the group, and a part of that, I'm also going to send here the online way of selling your chametz. You can go into many sites, whether it's Tzohar or the Jerusalem Rabbinate. You go and you sell the chametz through them. You don't sell it to the rabbi. You sell it through the rabbi to the non-Jew person, that he buys the chametz of all the Jews, and the whole of Pesach, it belongs to him. After Pesach, it comes back to us, but during Pesach, we are not allowed to eat it. Or to do anything with it. It's not ours. I'll say more than that. If you have any relatives, listen carefully, relatives or friends that you know are not so makpid, they don't really care about selling the chametz, remember, you will not be able to eat at their house after Pesach for a long while. Because if there was something that is not kosher for Pesach, and during Pesach, it was belonged to a Jew, although he closed it in the cupboard and didn't open, if it was owned by a Jew during Pesach, we are not allowed to eat it even after Pesach. This is something big, you have to remember. And so the way around it is to try and sell the chametz even of your relatives and friends. Preferably while they know about it, but even if they don't, you can do it on their behalf so they won't make the mistake of enjoying chametz during Pesach or after Pesach. During Pesach, the chametz belongs to the non-Jew, and we sell it to him wholeheartedly, with a full heart, and it's not a joke. And if that non-Jew comes and knocks on my door, where is my whiskey? I tell him, here, in that cupboard where I wrote chametz, it's yours. He will take it. It's his. He will pay for it because that's how it works. He should pay for what he takes. But if he comes, you have to give it to him. That's his. On Thursday night, exactly 1 week from today, on Thursday night, usually it's the night before Pesach. This year, because of Shabbat, it's two nights before Pesach, we search for the chametz. We take customly, we take a candle, but you can do it with a flashlight, a torch, or anything else. You look around, it's like the last rehearsal before Pesach, that you look around at all places that you might have left and forgot the chametz, whether it's the car, or the kids' bags, or the kitchen cupboards, or whatever, the kids' bedrooms. You try and see if we forgot something that is not kosher for Pesach, and that's what we do, is a search for the chametz. When I was growing up, it was a big thing. My mother and my sister used to hide 10 pieces of bread wrapped with a tin foil that we spoke about earlier, which is a big star, the tin foil. And then they hid it around the house. And me and my brothers were going around and searching for it. I grew up with that custom, and I carry on with my children. My wife and children next Thursday will hide those pieces of bread. And me and the boys will walk around and look for them. And if we find something, it's a big simcha. Wow, it's amazing. We take all the chametz. When we start the search, we say the bracha. Baruch ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech Haolam, Asher Kidashanu Mitzvotav Vetzivanu Al Bi'ur Chametz. It's for the burning of the chametz, which we will do the next day. But we said the bracha already now, because we're going to find the chametz that we're going to burn tomorrow. And then when we finish searching, we say a short paragraph in Aramaic, which actually reads that any chametz, any unleavened bread, any non-kosher for Pesach that is in my possession and I didn't see it, or I didn't remove it, or I didn't know about it, shall be nullified and become honorless, like the dust of the earth. That's what we say on that Thursday night when we finish the search for the chametz. And then those pieces of chametz that we found, we keep them until the morning. The next day, which this year is Friday morning, we burn it. We burn the chametz, literally burn. If it's too difficult for you to burn because you don't have a place to do it, then you can destroy it in other ways, whether you pour economica on it, or whether you just put it outside for the cats to eat. It's also okay, but we get rid of all the chametz. There is something I skip here, which is called Ta'anit Bechorot. It's not so important this year, but we come into the Seder. This year, we have to prepare for the Seder many things from even before Shabbat, not just 2 minutes before the Seder, but 25 hours before the Seder. And from today, start thinking of certain things. For example, I made a list of 10 things, so it will be easier to remember. The first one is called Haggadah. The special book for Pesach is called Haggadah Shel Pesach. And that book, you should try and buy one that has got a bit of commentaries, not something for children that's got just pictures. It should contain the whole Haggadah and with a little bit of remarks there. When do you pour from the wine? When do you uncover the matzot? All kind of little details that you have to have the right Haggadah with basic explanations in your language. If you can find in your language, that's the best. Even reading the Haggadah can be done at your language. It doesn't have to be done in Hebrew. Second thing we have to buy before the Shabbat, for the Shabbat and the Seder, that is wine or grape juice. We need to have the wine for the two times we say the Kiddush on Shabbat, and then we say four times Borei Pri HaGafen during the Seder night. We drink four cups of wine, and we also have to have enough wine for the cup of Elijah the prophet, because we're going to pour a cup for him as well. So we don't have to drink a full cup every time we drink one of the four. You have to drink most of it. So you should have enough wine for everybody at the Seder. That's important. We should have a nice glass, a nice cup, gavia, whatever it is, for each one of the participants that to drink the wine from. You know, when you have a siddur which is nice, it makes your whole atmosphere nicer. We should also have a nice cup for Eliyahu Hanavi that we're going to pour and not drink from. We should have at least 3 matzot each. On Shabbat, we make the blessing on 2 breads, 2 loaves of challah. But on Pesach, we make the blessing over 3. And we're going to have to eat all 3. You'll see in a second. We should have the Seder plate. I don't know if you can see this picture I'm showing you now. That's a Seder plate. And that should be at least 1 per Seder. And if he doesn't have the beautiful plate, it's okay. You can just put on little plates all those things that's supposed to be on that plate. And that is the charoset. Charoset is the sweet, tasty thing, you know, with apples and dates and whatever you people and raisins, whatever people put inside. Obviously, everybody think that their recipe is the best in the world, but you should learn how to make charoset. You'll see a million recipes on the internet. You make the charoset. We have to eat it during the seder. I'll show you when. With the maror. And maror is the bitter herb. Whether you take chrein, you know, the horseradish, I think it's called horseradish, or you take lettuce, it's also working for the maror. And then we have the karpas. The karpas is a celery or anything you make the blessing for. Borei pri adama could be a potato, is also okay. We have to have the egg. Remember, hard boiled egg should be boiled from before Shabbat. The same thing with the lettuce. We have to check for all kind of insects before Shabbat, not during Shabbat. And also in terms of the cooking of what is called the zroa. Zroa is representing the sacrifice of Pesach, and it should be cooked before Shabbat because we're not allowed to cook on Shabbat. Also, the salt water should be prepared before Shabbat. You should have a nice chair with handles, maybe with a place to put a little bit of a pillow, a cushion that you can lean towards. We lean to the left when we eat or drink the basic things of Pesach to show that we are free people. And remember that the meal on Motzei Shabbat, the meal of the Seder night, doesn't have to be so big. I always argue with my wife about this issue because she always likes to make lots of food. And I tell her, no, we read the whole Haggadah. By the time we get to the food, not the whole Haggadah, half the Haggadah, but by the time we tired already. And we also ate at least 1.5 matzah. So, you know, there's no room for so much food that you're making. But she doesn't listen to me and she makes the food anyway. And that's how it works. I think the last thing to say, number 10 here, is try to prepare. If you make the Seder on your own, try to read commentaries and explanations before so you can prepare your own things to say during the Haggadah so it will give it more meaning. Specifically this year, as I said, certain things need to be prepared from even before the Shabbat. And aside from all the food, we should also prepare the candles. So we're going to light the normal Shabbat candles before Shabbat. But before lighting them, we would also light the Yortzeit candle. It's called Ner Neshama. This Yortzeit candle we light so we can use the fire of that candle to light the Yom Tov candles on Saturday night. Only when Shabbat is totally finished, only then we can actually light the Yom Tov candles and we say the 2 brachot. Instead of Ladlik Ner Shel Shabbat, we say the Bracha Ladlik Ner Shel Yom Tov. Plus, many women say the Bracha of Shechayanu. Others won't because they're going to say it with the Kiddush a little bit later. If you have a time switch for the lights, remember that Seder night gets longer and make the time switch accordingly. If you want to cook, I don't like cooking on a Yom Tov, but it's allowed. If you like to make a barbecue or something, then you should still have light for that. In order to use electricity that you turn on, in order to turn a new fire, but only from an existing flame, that can be done on Sunday. But let's go back to Shabbat. Next Shabbat, not this Shabbat, is called Shabbat HaGadol. Many reasons why it's called Shabbat HaGadol. But anyway, on that Shabbat, already we are going to eat with the Pesach dishes. So we're going to change the dishes to Pesach on Friday afternoon. So the whole Shabbat meal and the next 7 days after that will be with the Pesach cutlery and plates and everything. Because on Shabbat we cannot change and we have to start eating kosher for Pesach. But we also have to eat bread. On Shabbat we have to eat bread. So the recommendation is not to buy challah or bread this next Shabbat, but only to buy a few pitot, because pita makes less crumbs. So what we do is we eat the pita outside. We say, so make the blessing over two pitot on Friday night, and again, two pitot on Shabbat lunch, and not lunch, much earlier than that. I'll tell that in a second. And then we make the bracha over the pita, and we eat them. When we finish eating the pita, we get rid of all the crumbs, and only then we go home to eat the Shabbat food, which was cooked in the Pesach dishes. Why don't we eat matzah on Pesach, on Erev Pesach? It's all the way from the Talmud. The Gemara already almost 2,000 years ago said that we are not allowed to eat matzah the day before Pesach. It's a common custom not to eat matzah a month before Pesach. That's what many people do, but we don't eat matzah the day before Pesach because we want the matzah to be special for the Seder. On a Seder, we're going to be excited to eat matzah after not eating it for a while. And that's why we don't eat matzah on the day before Pesach. So we eat the bread very carefully, and that should be done by 10 o'clock in the morning on Shabbat morning. So again, we eat the two pitot on Friday night. We eat another two pitot on Shabbat morning. By 10, we should be finished with all the chametz. We wash the mouth, we can carry on eating the fish or the chicken or whatever we eat during that meal. But by 10 o'clock, no more chametz. Then we say this sentence again. If you want to say it in Aramaic, it's good. If you want to say it in English, it's also okay. That any unnecessary non-kosher Pesach food that I didn't think of, for me, it's nothing. I'm going to throw it away. I try to get rid of everything. That's what we do. We have time, as we said, because it's a Shabbat. We can rest and we can go to sleep and get ready for the Seder. And then during the Seder, we have we're not allowed to prepare anything. We are not allowed to prepare anything for the Seder on Shabbat. Only once Shabbat came out, only when Shabbat finished, only then you can start even setting the table or getting dressed if you want to change. Whatever you do, you do it after Shabbat ends. And we also add the special Havdalah, you know, the separation between Shabbat and weekdays. We doing that on Saturday night, it's complicated. We have all kind of new additions to the Havdalah. Luckily, it's all in the Haggadah. It all appears in the Haggadah, and you don't have to remember it, but we do a Kiddush plus Havdalah all together. That's happening during the Seder night. Any questions? I'm sure you're going to have lots of questions. Please ask. I'm leaving the next 2 minutes for that. Who's jumping first?
So you recommend to do the blessing on the pita, not on the table. Is that right?
Exactly, because the table is already kosher for Pesach. All the dishes.
So where do I do it? On near the sink or what?
Near the sink or at the front door or something like that.
Okay. And then, so where do I put the bread on Friday night? Where do I put it? In a box?
Yeah, you keep it in a plastic bag or whatever. So there won't be any crumbs.
And then it will be on the table on Saturday morning.
Again, not to eat it there, still in a plastic bag, when you make the kiddush, and then you eat it somewhere.
But on Saturday morning, I can put it on the table.
No, because again, the dishes are kosher for Pesach.
So what do I do? But the challah, usually the pitot and the challah are on the table covered.
Yeah, you can do that. You can leave them in a plastic bag covered with whatever. But eat them when you open this bag. You should eat them somewhere else, not next to the next kosher for Pesach dishes. Anyone else?
And on Friday. It's not the Saturday morning at 10 o'clock, we stop eating chametz. Not on Friday, 10 o'clock.
Exactly. My time is almost up, so I'm going to wish you Chag Sameach. And if you have any questions, please don't hesitate. There's lots to say about Pesach. Hopefully we'll be free people and have a meaningful Seder. להתראות, חג שמח.
חג שמח.